Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. My name is Danielle Cylich, and I am a member of the board of the Neighborhood Preservation Center, and we are thrilled to host this special program tonight. Let this person join us. We had over 100 individuals register, so we are thrilled, and we know everyone is trickling in, and they're coming from Akron, and they're coming from Queens, and they're coming from Vancouver and Malaysia, so I know it takes a little bit of time to kind of get from all those spots over here, so we're going to slowly integrate everyone into our program. We're thrilled to have this presentation for you tonight. The Neighborhood Preservation Center is a nonprofit organization that began as a project of the St. Mark's Historic Landmark Fund on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. The St. Mark's Historic Landmark Fund created and sponsored the project to help shepherd a renovation of the rectory at the St. Mark's Church in the Bowery. During that time, NPC created a directory of publicly accessible resources, particularly online, for anyone interested in historic preservation, community gardens, and other community development related disciplines. Additionally, NPC oversaw the shared community use of the building. Today, NPC continues, but in a virtual space, such as the one we're sharing today, where we work towards enhancing vibrant, thriving, and equitable neighborhoods and communities, and one day hope to be back into a brick and mortar home ourselves. So a brief thank you to our co-sponsors, ioby and Open House New York, and to the NPC Program Committee for its efforts on today's event. So just a quick moment about our format. We are planning for a 25 to 30 minute presentation, after which there will be an opportunity for Q&A. So we ask that you type your questions in the chat, and if you would leave your name and affiliation, that would be great. We will plan after the presentation to present your questions, and we'll do our best to get them all in before 7 o'clock, but we want to be mindful of the time that we planned for this event. Okay, so I'm not sure if you remember getting your first library card, or if you still have your first library card, or if you have a library card, or if there was a favorite book, or maybe there was a favorite chair or a corner or a nook or a table where you used to sit in at your favorite library. Maybe it was your school library, maybe it was a public library. I believe that when we think of institutions that form essential core of neighborhoods, library is right there at the top of the list. And yet somehow libraries have always seemed more than just a place to borrow a book. So as we look out into the horizon, how are we thinking about library spaces and the relationship of libraries in our neighborhoods and to the people in those communities? Well, that is the very question before us this evening. So I'm delighted to introduce our speaker, Shamichael Hallman, who's Senior Library Manager at the Cossitt Library in Memphis, Tennessee, where he has helped oversee a multi-million dollar renovation of this historic building. The original library was a gift from one of Memphis's wealthy patrons, and ironically, it stood empty for a year after its Romanesque structure was completed in 1893 because of a lack of funds for books. But over time, there were books, and then there were additions and new and different architectural styles. But as with many public libraries, there's also a history of segregation and the struggle to allow access and use for all. But today, this library is witnessing a new vision. And so now I will turn it over to Shamichael to share the story and journey of the Cossitt Library.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen, and let's make sure that you can see that. Okay. Everyone see that? Okay, cool. All right, well, really, really excited to be with you all. I wanna thank Felicia and Danielle and really the entire NPC team for inviting me to speak with you all tonight, as well as a big thanks to Open House New York and ioby for sponsoring the event. And to each of you, friends, who have joined us tonight, My hope is that something will be said this evening that will make this event worth your time. And really quickly, I want to give a shout out to the Memphis Public Libraries. You know, organizations and media outlets across the country are recognizing that something special is happening in Memphis. And that's thanks in part to our leadership, Director Keena McCloy, Chris Marzalek, who was our deputy director, and hundreds of amazing staff within the system. And also a host of stakeholders within the city that are making this particular project that I'll be sharing with you tonight possible. Also, just want to give a quick shout out to my friends and colleagues who are part of the Reimagine the Civic Commons Initiative. Our library renovation is possible, made possible in part because of that initiative. It's been amazing to see the ways that folks in Philadelphia and Detroit and Chicago and Akron and San Jose, Minneapolis, Miami, Macon, Lexington, are demonstrating that transformative public spaces can connect people of all backgrounds and can cultivate trust and create more resilient communities. You know, through this initiative, it's been particularly exciting to see how practitioners are recognizing the intrinsic value of existing buildings, assets, and neighborhoods. And so whether that's a pump house in Akron, Schoeller Elementary School on the south side of Chicago, or a public library in downtown Memphis, we're seeing that working with communities to make the most of these existing assets can open up new possibilities and strengthen our civic commons. So as we think about this talk really kind of centers on this word reimagining, and I love to think about this word reimagine. I think about this definition of an opportunity to imagine again or to imagine anew. And I think many of us, if not all of us, have vivid memories of our first library experience. In fact, I imagine, and we were kind of heading that way just a few moments ago as Danielle was taking us there, that if we closed our eyes long enough and concentrated enough that we could probably still see some of the things that were in the very first library we ever encountered. Maybe it was the books or research materials, maybe it was the checkout desk, maybe it was a meeting room or reading area. But I think we all kind of have visceral memories of our public library. I know I certainly can. I grew up in a small town in Alabama, and the public library always played a vital and important role in my life. And whether you visited one recently or you still use them regularly, the fact is, and you can rest assured, that they are still in towns and cities across our country. In fact, thousands of libraries exist and daily serve the needs of their communities. They are essential places with essential workers providing essential services and resources. And what I've discovered, friends, in crossing over from a patron to a staff, is that libraries are always finding ways, new ways, to meet the needs of the communities that they're in. So for me, when I think about the word imagine, reimagine, it indicates to me a continued growth, a continued looking for opportunities as library staff and library workers to create equitable access, to champion literacy for all ages, to promote economic advancement and workforce development, to satisfy people's needs to know and learn new things. Reimagining for me indicates that we are always striving to create places where everybody belongs, that generate opportunities for shared experiences among people of all incomes and backgrounds. It indicates to me that we are always working to build a sense of community that brings people of all backgrounds into public life as advocates shaping the city's future. And that we're able to do that in a way that encourages additional investments in neighborhoods so that all these places are better places to live and to thrive. I'm sharing with you a little bit tonight about Cossitt Library, this project that I'm working on now. It has been a really wonderful experience. It is the city's first public library. As Danielle said, dates back to the 1890s. Very, very rich history. And it's played a pivotal role throughout the life of the city. And now we are in kind of in the final stages of renovating this really amazing space. And we think that not only will it serve as a vibrant neighborhood branch for the people who are in and around the downtown Memphis area, but will also be a destination branch capable of attracting visitors from a regional area and beyond. And so as we've been going through this process, this renovation process, this reimagining process for the last few years, certainly there are a number of things, a number of components that we could talk about, but I want to tonight really kind of root in, kind of ground our conversation on four core components. And that is design, outreach, programming, and partnerships. And I hope that throughout the conversation tonight, as we touch each of these, you'll be able to see how these four elements are helping us kind of reimagine this library. And I think, friends, that this is something that's broad enough to really touch many other spaces. Yes, this is what we're doing at libraries, but this could certainly be work at a community center, at a public park. The things that we've learned, the lessons that we've applied, I think have broad reach. So as we think about this to kind of kick us off, there's a really wonderful quote that I came across from FDR that I'd like to read. I think it kind of ground our time tonight. It says, libraries are directly and immediately involved in a conflict which divides our world, and for two reasons. First, because they are central to the functioning of a democratic society. Second, because the contemporary conflict touches the integrity of scholarship, the freedom of the mind, and even the survival of culture. And libraries are the great tools of scholarship, the great repositories of culture, and the great symbols of freedom of the mind. So we begin our conversation tonight with establishing the welcome. As I said before, as Danielle's already said, Cossitt Library is the first public library in the city of Memphis. For a number of reasons, the visitorship had declined over the years. And so we knew that one of the very first things we would have to do in order to make this renovation a success would be to create a welcoming environment that had the capacity and the potential to attract a broad audience. And so there are a couple of foundations, really, I would say four key foundations. And this is, a lot of this is really kind of rooted and grounded in the Civic Commons Initiative. But the first thing is really making sure that we extend a welcome to all, right? That we want to have a space and really be confident in that space, that it extends a welcome to everyone. So from the most affluent to the most vulnerable to people across the spectrum of ideologies, right? And this is a challenging thing to do. When we think about the polarization in our community, we think about the privatization of our community. It really takes some intentional staff training and community outreach and even high quality physical design to extend that welcome and ensure that everyone comes. And as we design these places, we want to make sure that they are as flexible as possible, if they're able to meet a variety of needs and use cases. Our communities are always changing. Things are always happening. Our community, people are moving in and out. Businesses are coming in and out. Things are always on the go. And so for us to be able to meet the needs of our community, we have to have the sort of spaces that are easily transformed, right? And so one of the things that we've done, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, but for instance, one of the things that we've done in our library is that all of the bookshelves, right, are on casters so that we can move them around based on what is needed. The third foundation is that we don't want to do this alone. We don't want to do this in a siloed approach. We want to actually have active participation from the community. In fact, we want the community to co-create this with us as we think about the sort of collection development, the books that we have, the resources that are available, the equipment that is available, the sorts of programs and events and activities that are available, that we don't want to develop those in a vacuum, that we want to be mindful and actually encourage the community to do that with us. And then lastly, we want to be very intentional about our programming, that we want to create opportunities for shared experiences, right? I love this. It is through shared experience, such as learning a new hobby or skill, that bonds of trust and affection can be formed. And I think we all know this. I certainly do. Before we close our building, I cannot tell you how many times we would have a sewing class or a program around taxes, where people from all walks, these things kind of affect everybody, where people from all walks of life would come together over a couple of weeks or even a month. And at some point in time, they start saying, hey, I see you here all the time. What's your name? Where are you from? Tell me about your life, right? These sort of opportunities for shared experience are very, very vital. So those are our foundations. And then with that, and we have, we've been working with a wonderful design group, Groundswell Design Group out of Philadelphia, to begin to put together a physical design robust enough to accomplish these things. And so for us, that looks like a couple of things. The first one is a courtyard. Before, we did not have a formal courtyard. We had kind of an open green space, but we decided that, that we need to be more intentional with that space. And so we paved half of that space, and you can see that there are a number of seating options there. There are some wonderful trees that are many years old that provide an amount of shade. And then a set of steps that bring you into the renovated space. And this is something that was not there before. And I gotta tell you, there are gonna be some really wonderful things that you'll see inside the building once we actually open. But this set of steps, I think, is perhaps the most impactful thing that happened in this entire space. It's kind of screams that you are welcomed in this space. It kind of creates this, not kind of, it does create this welcome, this statement that invites you to come into this outdoor gathering space. Not just that, we also have we have been mindful, as Danielle said earlier, pay tribute to the rich history of our library. One of those things is that in the 1960s, there was a great move by a number of young students, Black students who attended HBCUs here, to desegregate our library system. Up until this time, Black people had little to no access to the library system. There was actually a separate branch that was created for Black people. And thanks in part to these students and some amazing young lawyers, we were able to create a more equitable library. And so in our new library, we will have an installation that pays tribute both to the lawyers that tried the case that led to the desegregation of the library system, and also the individuals who were a part of that. In addition to that, we've added a cafe. This is very new for us. This is actually our first go at this. We're excited to introduce this to the community. It's a little under 1,000 square feet that will offer a variety of soups and salads and sandwiches, beverage options. And I think what we're most excited about is we've got a local chef that's gonna be doing this. It's not a library staff that's doing this. We found an amazing individual who has this wonderful story of being a kid and having the bookmobile in Memphis come to his neighborhood. And that by the time the bookmobile made it to his community, the only books that were left were the cookbooks. And that kind of was his introduction to cooking and his introduction to becoming a chef. And so we're excited to host him. In addition to this cafe space, we also have added a performance area that's right at 2,300 square feet. This particular space is really, really an amazing space for a number of reasons. It is very flexible, and we think will allow and support a variety of dance and music, acting and fitness classes. We've been in a really wonderful process, community engagement process, for the last few months now, led by Emily Marks, who's one of our staff. And we have spoken to almost 100 organizations, artists and arts organizations in the city. And one of the things that we hear time and time again is that there is a lack of inclusive and accessible and affordable performance space. And so we've worked out a co-op model that will essentially offer up this space to individuals, to these artistic organizations, to these budding entrepreneurs who want to get their craft and their art in front of people. I got to say, I mean, this is, I think, we've crunched some preliminary numbers, and we believe that we might have a six-figure impact alone just with this particular addition. In addition to the performance space, we added some studio spaces, studio spaces. We have a video space and a photography space. A video photography space and an audio space. So in the audio space, you think about anything that you would need to be able to, say, record a podcast or a music album, right? A voiceover. And then on the photography and video side, the things that you might need to do to take a family photo or record or take a picture of goods or services that you are providing to the community. And all the things that you need to be able to create here, whether it's a camera, a green screen, a microphone, a mixer, a software, that we'll be able to provide all of that to the community at no cost, essentially, with your library card will get you access to that. And people are already, I mean, again, we're a little ways from opening, but people are literally calling us every week saying, how can we get access to this space? It's something that the community is in dire need of and for. And so those are some of the things that you know, we think about this design of adding these spaces, keeping these spaces flexible and able to accommodate many uses. We think that kind of puts a welcome out there, and that gives us the capacity anyway to attract a diverse audience. But we can't stop there, right? We then have to move to actually engaging with the community. We have to let the community know that we're out here and that these things are happening. And so, you know, one approach might be to wait until the building is reopened, but we've decided that no, we don't want to do that. We want to, even while construction is happening, we want to be out and in front of the community, telling them about the things that have happened. And so we've been able to engage in a couple of initiatives that I'll share with you here. As you can see, this is the building that's empty. And so right before construction started, we had a number of community conversations. We invited various stakeholders, college students, downtown business owners, people who live downtown, tourist organizations, artists, entrepreneurs, you name it, to come in and begin to talk about what this space meant to them and what they would like to see in this space. I thought it was very, very important for people to see the progression, right? So we invited people to come in as we were tearing things down, as we were breaking things down. We invited people to come in when the building was completely empty. And then we're excited to very soon invite people in to see this renovated building. And we thought that it was important to extend that invitation to people of all ages. And so here we've partnered with a local organization, Bridge Builders, which is a phenomenal organization here in the city, and invited groups of teens to come and spend some time with us for them to also give their thoughts about what they might want to see in the building. We then went out into the community. We didn't want just to ask people to come to us. So we went out and we took flyers and posters. We took sticky notes. We went to farmers markets, we went to businesses, and we were really, really serious. We wanted to make sure that that everything that we did from a programmatic standpoint, everything that we did from a design standpoint was informed by the community. We didn't want to do this for the community. We wanted to do this with the community. I think we've done a pretty good job at that. And then even beyond that, we decided to do a pop-up at a local food hall. We were able to form a wonderful partnership with the food hall that had at the time about 10 different restaurants inside. They gave us a space here that's about 200 square feet. And we started to try to mimic what would be happening in the library. So we started doing some of the programs and events that we might have. We offered some of the books. We wanted to get people's opinions about the books that we had and what they might want to see. And then, of course, as you can see here, we asked people, what do you want to see at Cossitt, right? So people said all sorts of things. They wanted to see more books by Black people. They wanted to have a place where they could get coffee, but not have to feel like that they had to, you know, buy to stay there every hour, you know, to make sure they had internet. People told us all sorts of things. And we took all that into consideration. You know, every opinion, every thought, every sticky note that people wrote down, even if it was something that seemed like it was out of reach, we kept it because we thought, hey, we might not be able to do it now, but we'll come back to that at some point in time. And I can't tell you how impactful that pop-up was for us. And again, we did all of this without having a branch. And I said, we still don't have a functioning branch. It's coming soon. But we wanted to be intentional about getting out into the community. So then kind of this third pillar was attracting diverse audiences, right? That kind of beyond extending that welcome to everyone, we wanted to think about, okay, well, when we were open, when the building was open, who were the people that were not coming, right? And we took a lot of time. This was a long exercise for us. Over a couple of months, we looked at the demographics in the downtown community, the demographics in kind of the nearby community. And we started seeing, you know, who are these audience? Who are these people that don't come right now? And what could we do to begin to attract these audiences? We really believe that the public library should not be dominated by any one particular group, right? That this is a space that is for everybody. And I think, particularly at this moment in time in the history of our country, that we need these spaces, right? We need these spaces that regardless of where you slept last night, regardless of how much education you have, regardless of how much money you got in your pocket, there's a space where you belong. There's a space where you can come and be and that we will accept you as you are, right? And so we wanted to be very, very intentional about attracting diverse audiences. And so we did a number of things. We took the information that we got from all of those gatherings, you know, at the farmers markets, at the pop-ups, and as people were coming in, we took all that information and said, okay, let's figure out what we could do with what we have. And so we can't go inside the building, but we do have a courtyard. We have a front courtyard and a back courtyard. Let's use this space to begin to prototype and kind of pilot some of the programs that people have said. Let's go back to that board of ideas where people said, hey, we'd love to have dinner conversations. We'd love to be able to have music events. We'd love to be able to have cultural events. Let's go back to that board and let's start testing stuff out and see if we can use what we already have to start attracting those audiences, right? So here's an event that we did. You can see we hung some lights and we put out a portable sound system, and we, over the course of a month, invited different musical acts. We had country, we had rap, we had jazz, we had gospel, right? We wanted to have all these sorts of different people that were coming to perform. We did a human chess tournament, which was a lot of fun. You know, there were a lot of people who were looking for these sorts of opportunities to learn new things, right? And so this was a wonderful way for us to introduce chess to people who had never played before, and to the game who had it seemed intimidating to them. We had a number of pop-up events, and I want to show you a couple of these. This one was actually outdoor jazz yoga, trap yoga at sunset, right? So we're right on the Mississippi River, and the sun is going down, and you've got one of the individuals who's playing the saxophone. People are engaging in yoga, and I got a man, people were so excited about this. This guy was playing everything from contemporary jazz to hip-hop. It was a wonderful thing. Another night, we had an event out in the front of the courtyard where we had a fire thrower. Really amazing. Through all of these events, you know, we begin to see, right? Each of these, we begin to see different people. All of these didn't have, you know, 100 people attending, but all of them did have different types of people, different types of Memphians who were coming. And that was very, very important for us, because we said, hey, if we can create these sorts of events and we can attract these individuals, we can talk to them, we can engage them, we can hear more about what they would like to see. This is the side court. This is the side courtyard, which has almost a direct view of the Mississippi River. And we decided that, hey, in addition to us hosting things, how about we put this in the hands of other people? And so we happened to be right next door to the law school, the local law school. And so we asked them to host an event. And so they came and did a wonderful community event. And this one didn't require anything of us as a library staff. We just played host to this event. And again, it was a wonderful way to bring in new audiences, while also forging a wonderful partnership with the law school, who again is right next door to us. Of course, in COVID times, we also kind of found ways to continue to engage folks. And so we went across the street to where the river is, and we created these squares, these social distance squares, where we could do arts and crafts with children. And again, we saw parents who came to this and said, hey, I didn't even know there was a library downtown. I'd never been inside the library before. We were able to say, hey, mom, hey, dad, hey, grandma, hey, grandpa, hey, grandpa, hey, guardian, what would it take to get you back? What sorts of books do your child love? What sorts of events do they like to do, right? And all these things have informed and shaped the sort of programming that we've done. And so we've been able to take all of that and put it into this existing framework that some wonderful folks have worked on. This actually came out of the Library Quarterly in 2020, where they identified these kind of seven pillars for creating programs, right? These kind of seven outcomes and objectives, right? So participants learn new knowledge, number one. Second one is that they learn new skills. Third one is that they change their attitudes. Maybe they come in contact with someone they never had come in contact with before, that maybe they had a prejudice against before. And through maybe a shared meal or a shared experience, they change their attitudes toward that person. Number four, they change their behaviors, right? So we're able to say to have financial literacy courses or addiction-related courses, right? And people are able to start a new start, a new path in their life. Number five was people gain awareness of library resources, services, and programs, right? Some people think, oh, it's just books inside that library. When in fact, there's so many other things. There are a number of other services and resources, databases, magazine, ebooks, connections to counseling services and housing services. There's so much that happens inside a public library that many people never think about. Of course, we want people to have fun, right? And so we, you know, game nights and bringing in and weaving in the arts and weaving in music, weaving in food, weaving in comedy, gave us opportunities to create activities. And then lastly, our participants exposed something new, right? Maybe a new food, a new recipe, a new art style, or engage or meet with people in dialogue that they would not meet otherwise. And so taking all of these kind of activities, all these conversations, all these pop-up activities, prototype activities, and using this framework, we've been able now to create about 65 programs that we think will get us through the first year and help us meet that goal of bringing in new and diverse audiences. And then lastly, as we have developed some of these programs and we talk about some of these spaces, we recognize that we've got to up our game, right? That in addition to making laptops and tablets accessible to the community, that we've got to get things that the community craves, but they might not be able to afford. And so we've got, as you see here, 4K cameras. We've got digital SLR cameras. We've got podcasting equipment. We've got things for maker spaces. And again, you know, even as we've kind of already had pop-up programs where we introduce these things to people, where they get to kind of touch them, put their hands on them, start playing around with them, we've been amazed at people who say, "Hey, man, I'm so happy that the library is providing this. I can't afford to pay, you know, a couple hundred dollars a year for Adobe Cloud or for some editing software, but the library's making this available to me. It's really life-changing to me." And so as we bring in these new audiences, as we bring in these diverse audiences, we recognize that we have to do things to create a sense of ownership, right? That we don't want people to say, "Oh, that's that library." We want people to say, "That's my library." And if we can get people to say, "That's my library," then that creates a sort of ownership, creates a sort of a sense of stewardship that people begin to see themselves as not just consumers of the library, but co-collaborators with the library. So we've done a couple of things here. First has been partnerships, right? And so again, even without having a building, we've been able to work with a number of local organizations here. ArtUp is a local incubator for small businesses, particularly for artistic entrepreneurs. They offer a range of courses and activities. And so what we have done is work with them to make sure that those entrepreneurs, number one, give voice to what they need, right? We've asked them, "Hey, as we are getting ready to purchase equipment and software and resources, we want to make sure it's what you need. So can you take some time to walk us through your practice? Can you take us through some time to show us how you create, to show us how you sell, right?" And that's helped us to make sure that we're purchasing the right things. But we're also able to expose them and offer them resources that we already have, databases that can help them research new client bases, right? Databases that can help them understand where they can go to produce their goods and services. So we've got a long list of organizations that we've been able to partner with. And these people now see themselves as an extension of the library. They see themselves as playing a pivotal and vital role in the life of the library. And that is something that we don't take lightly. And not only think about partnerships, but we also think about the individuals who are coming, right? And so as we think about our Friends of the Library program, one of the things that we recognize is that our Friends program, and this is by their own admission, was a small group that skewed more older and more white. And they said, "Hey, you know, if we're gonna last, if we're gonna make it past this renovation, we've gotta diversify our group. We've gotta bring in some different voices. We've gotta bring in some youth, gotta bring some people of color," right? And so we've worked with them, and this is the work of a wonderful staff person, NJ Robinson, created a new logo for us. And this is actually a play on our building. You can see this is a multi-story library, which our library is two stories. And this is the front door, and this is a bookmark. This is a signature part of the Memphis Public Library. And we've created a host of swag, right? T-shirts and mugs and hoodies that we use now to entice people to become friends of the library. And we say that, hey, as a friend, not only do we want a financial donation, a small financial donation, we want you to be active part of this. We want you to be a part of our programming. We want you to be a part of our planning process. We even want you to be able to give voice on how we allocate our funding, right? And people have been very, very excited about that. And so what we think now, you know, kind of wrapping up, that as we've given thought, as we hope, careful thought to this design, outreach, programming, and partnerships, that we're going to create a space that is truly transformative, that we're going to create a space that can really be a pivotal resource in our community. And so as we, you know, we've got a little bit ways more before we open. But friends, I believe that because of this work that we have done on the front end, that we're going to have a truly transformative space that will serve as a model for libraries in Memphis, United States, and beyond. Thank you so much. I want to stop now and make sure that we have time to take questions and have some dialogue. I'd love to hear anything, your thoughts that you might have, questions you might have. And I hope that we can dialogue a little bit together.
Yeah, thank you. That was inspiring. And I think there was a question that was put in the chat, and we'll ask that one first. It was kind of one that I was sort of was thinking as well, and that is sort of you know, the role of the librarian, and it's such an interesting job. It's not quite the job you thought of back in the day with the Dewey Decimal System, and now I'm dating myself. But sort of as this is a progressive community connection, right? And so I'll ask one of the questions we had in the chat is, so what do you think of librarians becoming literary community organizers? So that I guess we can, you know, stage readings in the neighborhoods, community readings during evenings and weekends, times when libraries are closed. So, you know, the challenge of you can't be open 24/7.
Right, right, yeah. Yeah, not only can you not be open 24/7, there's only so much you can do as librarians, right? And so I think a couple of things there. You know, I have had the wonderful opportunity of seeing libraries all over the world. And what I know is that librarians and library professionals are some of the hardest working folks that you would ever meet. Some of the most compassionate folks that you would ever meet. And they are always looking for ways to meet the needs of their community. And so what we owe them, I think, as a community, as residents of the community, is to always be fighting for our libraries, to ensure that not only do libraries have funding, but that library staff are paid a good wage, right? That librarians are delivering an essential service to our communities. I cannot tell you how many people who have come through, you know, I'll give you a very quick story, Danielle, and then I'm gonna answer the question. There was a gentleman who, before we closed, who came to our branch and he had just been laid off. And he said, you know, I've got to find another job. I got to feed my family. I heard about this other organization across the street from me that is hiring. I have no idea how to get started. So we went to the website and we looked at the job that he had found. And the job required, number one, he have a resume, that he have an email address, and that he know how to go online and create an account and upload that resume. This gentleman didn't know how to do any of those things. Yeah, he had no knowledge of it. He didn't have a resume. He didn't have an email. He was very much digital illiterate. And so over the next hour, our staff worked with him, right, to ensure that he could get all of those things done. And he came back a couple of weeks later and said, I got the job, right? What I'm saying is that, you know, what we ask of librarians is a lot. And so what we should be paying librarians is in accordance to what we are asking of them. But I do absolutely love the idea, Hugh, of having community readings, of having stage readings in community libraries. I think it's a wonderful thing to do. Now, you know, in terms of doing that when libraries are closed, I think that we've got some work to do there, right? And I think one of the things that we can do is just always have our ear. I mean library staff, library leaders, government leaders, always have our ear to the streets of knowing what our communities actually need and being able to respond to those needs as they come about. So I think it's a wonderful idea, Hugh. And I would encourage you, if you haven't done already, to go find your local library branch and recommend it to them, and even work with them to make it happen. I would imagine that they'd be pretty much open to that.
Great. So next comment and question, the model here is that's being developed is incredible. Is it replicable? How do we encourage libraries across the country to adopt your vision shared here?
Well, and Ernest, I think that's a great question. And I would actually push back a little bit and say that there are libraries that are already doing it. You know, I make no bones about that much of what we're doing, I pulled from other libraries. Right? When I think about wonderful things that are happening in the New York Public Library, I mean, they're always pushing the boundaries, right? Philadelphia, Toronto, Seattle, Akron. There are libraries that are already doing this work, really doing this amazing work. I think as much as librarians, we can be talking about these things, as much as citizens, we can be encouraging our local officials, our library officials to move in this direction. And again, to make sure that the funding's in place to do that, right? Because sometimes I think that the desire is there and the funding is not there, right? And to also think about, and the reason that I wanted to show you all kind of what we've been doing up until this point is that sometimes I think we think that, okay, we've got to have this amazing, shiny, brand new space to be able to do this. And yes, that certainly helps. Please don't get me wrong. That certainly helps. But there are little things. There are small things that we can do kind of right now, right? The pop-up, the prototyping, the kind of testing ideas out, the getting in the community, really listening to them and having the community come in and feeling like, hey, I can give my voice to this. I think there are things that we can already do now to move our library in that direction. But I would say, I'd almost be willing to bet you that there's a library close to you right now that's doing some version of this.
Probably. Our library, I live outside of Westchester and just recently moved, but it was actually the vision of a young teenage woman who thought that the children in the community should have books. And she started a lending library, started off on the second floor of a building on a main street and kind of moved around until it found its home. And the visioning for expanding it was about more access for not books per se, but the people who would read those books. So actually talking about people and using the spaces, one of the other questions we had was back to, I hear the advocacy in you. So for staff, how engaged were staff in your process? Where was their voice in this? And how do you work with them to build this future together?
Yeah, you know, none of this is possible without staff. I mean, we have some amazing folks. And one of the things that, and I give all credit to Keena McClure, our library director, she made a conscious decision. I think this might've been maybe a decade ago, if I'm correct, I might be a little wrong there, to open up who could actually apply to be a librarian, right? That in many times, you know, there's a requirement that you've got to have a master of library science, you know, degree to even work in a library. And she said, hey, no, that's giving us a certain type of person. And it's there's an opportunity for us to bring in new and fresh and diverse voices and perspectives. And so what you'll see in the Memphis Public Library is, you know, poli science folks and engineers and, you know, psychology majors and a little bit of everything, right? But the staff that we have as Cossitt is really amazing. We've got someone who spent her entire life in the arts and has helped kind of inform how we engage with the arts community. We've got a world-renowned photographer and videographer who's come aboard and will be giving, you know, kind of master classes to the community around photography and videography. We've got an individual, you know, who, you know, self-taught almost any and everything that you could do in an Adobe cloud suite. You know, she taught herself how to do it and is now ready and prepared to teach that to the community, right? And so staff has been amazing in this. Every program that we have created, those kind of seven programming frameworks that I told you about, that was all collective, right? That was, none of that was just me, that was all collective staff. And I always maybe want to give them kudos for what they did.
Great. I'm gonna, there's a funding question. I think that was one of the things I had written down earlier too, but that's probably a bigger question. So we'll come back to that right before the end. But just curious about your perspective on making room for human service partnerships in library spaces. And I know certainly I've seen that in our local communities, that place for, as you said, other connections, but how broadly do you think that, you know, should go or not go, or is that, you know, different for each community?
Yeah, I think it's different for each community. I'm all for it, right? I'm of the opinion that if you're going to create a space where you hope everyone shows up, then you got to be prepared when everyone shows up, right? You got to be prepared. And we know, particularly for, and this is not just for us, I think this is many librarians who are in an urban core, that we have a significant amount of our customers are up from the unhoused community, right? And so we've been working to not only work with the community to try to remove the stigma of homelessness, right? Because there are people who have a very set opinion about what they think a homeless person is, you know, someone who's this or that, when it's not just that and this, it's so many other things. One of the things that our library has done is actually, and we're in the process now of bringing on part-time social workers. And we'll certainly have the space in our library for that person. So that, again, regardless of where you are, you know, I think this goes beyond, you know, class. I mean, you know, that when you come to the library, if you're there, you want to be able to meet the needs that you have. And so we'll see how that goes. We've certainly have seen phenomenal success in other libraries where they've had social workers and provided other human services inside the branch.
Great. Someone reminded me, I missed a question I did see earlier about the cafe. You know, how exciting to be able to eat in a library or near a library or food with books in a library. So, you know, it's kind of like, are you able to go and just eat at the cafe, or sort of how does that work together?
Yeah, so, you know, the way that it's designed, the way that we've designed it is, you know, to get to the cafe, you have to come into the library, right? So there's not like a separate door for the cafe. So we entice you to come inside. If we can get you inside, then we can convince you to hang around for a little bit. But this is new for us. You know, this is going to be a learning journey for us. Again, we have a wonderful chef who has a very long history of working with lots of different folks. And so his menu has a lot of different price points, right? And again, we go back to, we understand that we have an unhoused community and we have people who come through that branch, who might come through that branch, who can't afford it, right? And so we're always working on things. And right now we have a couple of ways that we're going to try to tackle that. We'll have a donation jar, right? Where people, you know, can kind of pay it forward if they like to. But we will have a signature menu item that'll cost a little bit more than what you normally expect to pay, right? And we're letting people know that, hey, if you buy this item, it will help make sure that anybody who comes here will be able to get something to eat. You know, it may not be the most expensive thing, but they'll be able to get something to eat. And again, this is going to be an experiment. You know, this is we'll learn as we go. But yeah, I mean, people are able to roam throughout the library with their food. The only places where we asking people not to go are the places where there's electronic equipment, right? So where our computers and tablets and those sorts of things are. But we've created lots of other spaces where there's, you know, tile cement floor where people can go and eat and not worry about, you know, if they spill a cup of coffee that they're going to be kicked out of the library.
And yeah, that's always the yikes. I got crumbs on my library book. Do you have a colleague, a friend around the corner who says, hello, Dorian, future site of the city's art museum, Brooks Museum, being built a block away. Have you thought further into the future about a vision for partnerships and revitalization of that section of Front Street? So a more specific question to your neighborhood and just getting your position in the neighborhood.
Yeah, y'all, Mark. Listen, I'm going to be very unashamedly plug Dorian, man. Dorian is an amazing human being. You should get to know Dorian, look up Dorian Spears. She's doing some phenomenal work across the country. So as Dorian said, we are kind of in the heart of downtown Memphis, and we will be eventually next door to the city's art museum, the Brooks Museum. And we've actually had a wonderful chat with them last week, Dorian, about a number of partnerships and programs. And one of the things that that I'm most excited about as we go back to the unhoused community is creating a set of programs that brings art to that community who's often shut out. You know, I tell people a lot about this one particular individual who would come to the branch, and one of the most talented people that I knew, he was an unhoused individual. He would be one of the first people that would be at the door when we would open our branch. And he would come in the mornings and he'd just pick a random section of the library, and he'd grab a book, you know, open the book up, and he'd see a picture. You know, it could be a photo of a person or a building, an animal. He'd study it for a few minutes, and he'd close the book and put it back on the shelf. And he'd go down to a table with a number two pencil, and it just as immaculately as you could imagine, draw it exactly what he's seeing. And Danielle, it is everything that he drew, everything that he sketched, in my opinion, was worthy of being in a museum, right? Wow. and so providing access to arts, providing an opportunity for that individual to display his art, to sell his art, to get access to art supplies, is, I think, one of the wonderful things that we'll be able to do when the Brooks Museum gets next to us.
Wow, you just never know how these shared public spaces, you know, impact us, impact our neighbors, and impact other people who we don't even know in our community. If I could, I guess we'll do a quick funding question. I know these are broader discussions. Does your particular library have grants and then sponsors and just your renovation process, sort of how was that funded?
Yeah, so, you know, I'll do a couple things here. The first thing is I will invite your listeners to check out. So Memphis Public Libraries were featured in the Smithsonian Magazine. I'll toot our horn a little bit that we were shouted out as one of the most innovative public libraries in the country. and in that article, there's a good piece there about how our library director tackled funding and the things that she did to increase funding. So, you know, I give really all hats off to our library director, our city government that has made great strides in providing for the public library. And then also, we are also very, very grateful to, I mentioned earlier in the conversation that we are part of the Civic Commons Initiative, which is focused on public spaces across the country. And thanks to some wonderful funders there, Knight, Kresge, JPB, Rockefeller, we're able to do some really cool things as well. So check out if you check out the Smithsonian article, you'll see some of the things that were approached from a funding perspective that could answer some of those questions.
Great. And then if I could ask a design question, just to sort of to go back, you know, you started out with that wonderful first step, and that's the welcome. So you had an existing building that had evolved over time. How did you determine, you know, which architectural firm you were dealing with, and how did that process approach and evolve to what you all thought was the right reuse of an existing space?
Yeah, and again, you know, I think that goes back to our leadership. You know, they, I would say that there were leadership and then a number of people downtown, stakeholders downtown, you know, who saw the possibility of what this library could be. And through a number of, I know that we engaged a design thinking firm who came in and spent a lot of time inside the branch and really, you know, engaged with the community to see what they needed. And then you see the slides that I shared there with Groundswell Design Group. They're just an amazing, those folks are fantastic. And so I think, you know, when you start with that sort of vision at the top, some dedicated stakeholders in the community, and then this, you know, kind of wonderful organization, you end up with the magic that will ultimately arrive at.
So did you always think you were going to be a librarian?
No, I have no library experience at all. This is I'm learning this on the fly. I've always loved libraries, but this has been
Well, you know, I'm inspired. I always sort of half joke that, you know, I don't know what I'm going to be when I grow up, but I think I want to be a librarian now.
Librarians are cool people, man. They're some cool folks.
They really are. So I'm not sure if there are any other questions. You can quickly, you know, type them in the chat. We still do have another minute or two. And so, you know, perhaps the vision you all have arrived at speaks to, I think, such real thought. And it truly is amazing, a real thoughtful process across a spectrum, and who is the community, who are the people out there, but also, you know, what does it mean to be a library? Again, just, you know, where we started off with this, it was this building that had these things called books in them. I'm not sure some people even know what books are anymore. But the thought of what that institution is, and I'm so thankful for that quote from FDR, because it resonates beyond that. And yet at the same time, I think there's something very physical about holding a book, about opening it up and reading it at your leisure. You're not scrolling on your phone or your iPad. Maybe we'll just sort of end, if I could ask you sort of that question, is, you know, that dichotomy of, you know, there's a community outreach and a need that helps foster and support this particular space. And it's initial start of this repository, perhaps for our history, our thinking, our understanding, these scrolls, these books, and the digital age. And I don't even know where it will go from here, but maybe that could be sort of a last thought from you.
Yeah, you know, and I think it is, and I see Vivian's question, when will it open? But the answer is soon. I can't put a definite date out there, but the answer is soon. And when we do so, we'll certainly let you all know. The public library. I mean, as I think about like now, right, you know, we have a strategic plan that's available on our city's website, on the library's website, where the library, you know, talks about these kind of six things that it hopes to advance, right? That we want to create equitable access, that we want to champion literacy for people of all ages, that we want to promote economic advancement and workforce development. We want to advance the library's role as community anchor. That we want to increase the community's awareness of all that we have, the books, the other resources, and that we want to be very strategic in that, you know, in partnering with the community to do those things. This will be ongoing work for us, right? And the thing that I know is that librarians and libraries have, in my research anyway, always found ways to meet the needs of the community, right? And of course, at the heart of that is always going to be, you know, access to knowledge and information, free access to knowledge and information, kind of satisfying a desire to need and know and learn things, right? But the way in which we do that, I think we'll always pivot. You know, books, people still love books. People still love to come and put their hands on physical books and all sorts of books. But people also love to, you know, other new ways to learn. They love to get their hands on technology. They love to see videos. You know, they love to be beside people and learn together, right? And so we'll continue to find ways, we'll continue to pivot. You know, I think this will get us for a couple of years, and we might decide, you know, or discover in a couple of years that we've got to make other pivots. And so we'll always be able to keeping our ear to the ground, finding ways to meet those needs.
Wow. Well, I think we've reached our hour. We're actually 1 minute over. So I want to just thank everyone for joining us. And for all of your terrific questions, I certainly want to thank you, Shamichael, for sharing with us. It's really quite an inspiring journey. I think it really helps us think about our interconnections in our community, and you know, whether they start or end at the library, but it's definitely a place to ensure that we've visited and that we've supported, and that we've supported our local librarians. You guys are doing some amazing work. So I think, again, thank you to everyone. We hope you've had a great evening. We did record this, and at some point we hope to have it posted on our website. And we hope we'll see everyone soon at another program. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. Night.